So Adam Booth, Abom79, has been working on a weld test fixture for me, a back purge weld test fixture like you would use in aerospace testing. And he did a video series on that, and he sent it to me, and I've got it now. So today I'm going to do the first two welds on it, one stainless, one aluminum. Let's do it. So in this video, I'm going to first show a few clips of Adam making the fixture, and then I'm going to make the very first weld on it, which is going to be just a stainless plate, 063 thickness, nothing special, just a 304L stainless, but then also an aluminum joint, 6061. And along the way, I'll try to provide some tips, things that I have learned and given a whole bunch of these tests. A big thanks to Adam for working on this project with me. And another friend of mine I'd like to say thank you to is my friend Mike Best for making the drawings. I will make them available for download on my website. You'll see a link in the description of this video. This big chunk, the base of it, is 3 inches thick by 6 inches by 12 inches. Didn't really need to be that big, but smaller ones I have used in the past got hot after 10 or 20 plates. So these hold-down bars are made of steel, and the insert is copper. So the copper insert has been milled. It also gets holes drilled in it about every quarter inch, 1/16th holes about every quarter inch. That's give or take. This brass tube runs the whole length of the fixture, pretty much, in the argon cavity that was milled in there. And this is silver brazing a little plug on the end of that tube, and then the fitting on the other end, where this will just screw in. After that's cleaned up, it's pretty much ready to go after a blackening of those hold-down bars. Almost too pretty to weld on and scratch up, but just almost. I'm definitely going to weld on it. But this thing is just beautiful. And the final touch was this tag that Adam had made with our combined logos on there. So serial number 001. That's pretty cool. All right, let's get into the process now. One of the most important things is filing an edge on a joint like this. It's best to use a clean new file, followed by an acetone wipe. Sometimes you might use a fine abrasive to knock down an oxide layer. Depends on the alloy. This is just 304L stainless. Doesn't really require anything other than a filing and a wiping. It would be rare to weld this alloy for a test. Mostly it would be something like 321, 17-7. I've got a whole article on the page on my website that explains a lot of the process for testing. 10 CFH on the fixture. And I will use some small pieces of tape to tape off the unused portion of the argon trough. This is a nice Weldtech SW 320 amp water cooled torch I'll be using. And on that number 12 cup, I'll be using about 25 CFH. This stands quite a ways up off the table because it's pretty thick. So I'm using this little block that I made a while back to get comfortable with. That's what I'll do for this stainless joint. Filler wire, even though it looks clean, it's usually not. There's usually some residue from wire drawing lubricants and things like that. Now that I've cleaned the wire, I'm ready to tack the ends. I'm adding a little extra wire on each tack, a couple of extra dabs. I like heavy tacks when I tack on the very end like that. It gives me some, like a launching pad to prevent from melting away when I travel from, and it also gives me a little extra second when I get to a heavy tack on the very end when things are kind of heated up. So you don't even have to tack a joint like this. The fixture will hold it down pretty well, especially if you really lock it down. The reason I gapped it, two reasons. Number one, it helps it distort less. And even though I gapped it about, say, 040 or so, it pulled shut to where it's less than 030 now, and it just really helps me see the line. It's not at all necessary to have a gap to get full penetration on something this thin. But sometimes it just depends on the alloy. Sometimes a gap helps. Sometimes it hurts. 51 amps it takes to penetrate this stuff. That was what I settled in at. It would probably take a little bit less than that if it wasn't such a chill block. Anytime you put something in a fixture that's a heat sink or a chill block like this, it's going to take a few more amps to weld than it would be out in its free state. But you have to have something to hold it down and keep it straight. And a fixture like this is very common in the industry. Let's take another quick look at that tapering off there. Again, this is why I put a little bit heavier tack on the ends. And I'll show the other end in a minute. But once I get about right here, I start letting off the foot pedal a little bit. Then I keep a really close eye on the leading edge of that puddle. And when I watch it run about halfway into that tack, then I really get off on the foot pedal and then back up the arc a little bit as I taper off slowly.
And that works really well for not only a test like this, but it works for actual aircraft parts when you're welding a crack out to the edge of something like that. And then you have to maybe blend it off flush afterwards. It's just really a good technique. Now, something I didn't mention, there's a reason why I'm welding this in halves, and it's called backstep welding when I weld to a previous weld. And that basically is because this is what I required when I had to administer these tests. I thought it was a pretty bad idea not to have any stops and starts, so this at least demonstrates the ability to taper off and not leave a crater crack or a crater eye on some of these crack-sensitive alloys. So you can see there in slow motion, it works just as well coming from attack as it does tying into attack. And then when I tie into the previous weld here, I just keep the torch moving, add less and less filler, and kind of comet trail on out. And that wound up being about the best technique I could find for crack-sensitive alloys like Inconel 718, 4130 chromoly, or 15-7PH stainless. Let's look at it backside now and see if the fixture did its job, see what the purge looks like. It looks pretty good. It looks like we can tweak it a little bit with the flow rate and maybe the amount of tape I put on there and maybe some other things and get it even better on the backside. Usually you have to make some adjustments on them to get them just perfect where that backside is completely silver end to end. But I'll get there in practicing on some more of this stainless and some titanium and some other alloys for future videos. Well, I captured this additional arc shot here of welding to attack, and I was a little hotter and let it run up in there a little bit farther than on the previous one. But it's just a good example of how it gives you that extra, I don't know, half a second or maybe even less to let off the pedal, and having that little bit of a heavy tack there sometimes makes all the difference. Even though the code allows you to pretty much melt that into way on a test piece, that's not something you want to do on an actual aircraft part. So it's just a good technique for the test as well as actual parts. All right, well, let's take a look at an old fixture. This is the first fixture I made for giving tests like this. It was just one of those situations where a bulletin came down and I had to start testing welders right away and couldn't wait on a tooling request. So I made this in about a day, cobbled it out of a piece of steel and a plasma cutter, and up inside here is some diffuser material with a tube running the full distance, and just a bunch of stuff tacked together so that I could get going quickly. And it worked pretty well. It worked well enough anyway while I had a tooling request submitted and while better ones were being built. In this case, I used a slightly larger filler metal. I think I used a 1/16 filler here. That's another tip. I used an 045 filler in the previous plate on the better fixture, but you can see the very distinct and kind of choppy looking ripples there. That's from using a larger filler wire. So usually on stainless, one size smaller is a good rule of thumb than whatever you would use on chromoly or carbon steel. So you see that fixture didn't quite purge as well. It could just be I had the flow rate a little bit low, but I just thought I would show that. And this is a ceramic 12 Furet cup welding just on an outside corner joint with no fixture. I just thought it was a kind of a cool clip, so I thought I'd throw it in there. All right, next is an aluminum joint in the same thickness, 063. For me, it works better with no gap, and so I'm going to get tacks on each end. I'm using my TIG finger product here, not for heat resistance in this case, but just because it slides so smoothly along that bar, and I want to make a whole run. I'm not going to stop halfway on this one. I'm going to weld it end to end. So first thing I'm going to do is get tacks on each end, and again I'm going to add a little bit of extra filler metal, a few extra dabs for the same reason, because it's going to help me prevent blowing that end away when I get there. And then I'm going to weld the whole thing in one run without stopping. So I'm using a 1/16 4043 filler metal here. I'll show that again because you can see my electrode is a little bit bigger than it needs to be. This is a 332 electrode. Probably a 1/16 would have prevented that arc wandering, but it's workable. I'm going to be up in the close to 80 amps, somewhere between 75 and 80 amps at the hottest point of this joint. So it's in that range. Now this is how I'm going to feed my filler. This is how I usually feed my filler. Pinch it between my first two fingers and alternately grasp it between my palm and my thumb there. It's just something that takes practice, and to get good at it where it feels second nature, the best way is just sit in your chair. If you're ever watching TV or if you're doing something mindless, just practice feeding rod with your filler wire hand and just find a way that works for you and get good at it. I'm using a number 8 clear cup here. And you can watch me light up on this tack just like you did on the stainless. And it gives me an extra half a second or so to prevent from melting that end away. And the technique works on pretty much every metal that I've ever welded. Definitely not the only way to do it, but it works. Now, for passing a test like this on aluminum, I have found that having my AC balance setting with quite a bit of cleaning helps in passing X-ray. And also, I don't typically use the higher frequencies. This is set at 77 hertz, which is just slightly higher than what you can get out of a transformer type machine. But all I'm saying is that's what worked. That's what yielded the best results when we had to stop and test things and figure out where porosity was coming from. So I just kind of leaned into those settings. Almost made it all the way. We're coming up on that tack. Start letting off right here. I'm leaving the rod in the puddle, tapering off. There we go. Now you can see there's quite a wide white band of cleaning action outside the toe of the weld, and that's fine. There's no requirement in the code for limiting that, unless the engineering authority wants to for some reason. So that's penetration side, fully penetrated from one tack to the other, and then welded completely end to end with plenty of cleaning. Another way to do this joint, instead of tacking each end first, is just gapping it on one end only. And then the shrinkage of the weld metal will just pull it shut. If you gap it right, it just takes a little bit of trial and error to figure out the optimum gap. The weld will shrink the gap shut right in front of you, and you don't have to tack it or anything. You just weld it from end to end. Now this one I probably welded a couple amps colder than the other one, but still got through there. Well, hey, I have an online store at weldmonger.com. That is how I pay for these videos. And everything for sale there is stuff that I have used. This dual flow meter is good for when you need a purge and you need an extra flow meter without an extra cylinder. The TIG finger is not only good for protecting your finger against really hot stuff, but for just gliding along in cases when you just want to slide along smoothly and make a long run. This is a Furic number 12 clear cup, also available in a ceramic. And this is the Furic number 8 Pro, which not only provides really good gas shielding, but just kind of lights the way like a light bulb and helps you see where you're going. Thanks for watching. Thanks for your support. We'll see you here next time.